So, welcome back to the second part of the first session. After two talks, two interesting presentations about play and about reading, I would like to introduce the next presenter. Is Rosa Bankman. Some of you might know her as an artist, video artist, or also as a VJ. Well, I remember that she once performed in Ankara on the show for us. Thank you very much. I want to introduce her now. She will talk about from artifacts to filter, the tipping point of failure, but it's not really that, huh? I give it to you, you will say.
No, it's not really that. That is the title of research that led up to what I'm going to present now. So it is about failures, about artifacts, but it's actually called a good study for me says no. I've done a presentation before and actually halfway somebody asked me, what is a glitch? So I thought I would just... I'm not going to go deeper into it right now, it would be the fourth point or something, but I thought just give you an example, this could be understood as a glitch. Could be, doesn't need to be, per se. I'm a visual artist, I make videos and photos, and sometimes I do visuals for music. And this is how I got to doing this research, is to try to find some kind of technological translations from the sound to the visuals. And I found this whole area of compressions and glitches and feedback that I thought for the sound, but also the visuals. So that's where the artifacts, the noise artifacts came in. And now I'm going to specify later on into just glitches. Yeah, this is what you get when you go from Keynote to PowerPoint. Everything shifts just a little bit, but you can still read it, so it doesn't matter. The dominant continuing search for noiseless channel has been and will always be no more than a regrettable, ill-fated dogma. We all believe, or we all act like every new medium is supposed to be better because we pay more for it. But after a couple of years, actually, we paid so much for this last medium, and the next medium is actually cheaper, and it can do more. So, or at least it feels like this. It's this ongoing sort of surfing of flows of technology and waves, these vortexes that collapse. And every time we're just sort of trying to keep on wave riding this sort of vortex, and it's always sort of disappointing. It's like following a proprietary protocol. Yeah, we get sort of tricked into paying money, or at least I feel it. So, with a couple of examples of artworks that are made with noise artifacts, exploitations of the medium. One is a very old one, it's from Len Lay from New Zealand. Don't know if you know him. If you don't, you should really look up this video because it's very, very beautiful. It's this celluloid, and he scratches it, and he paints it, and he plays it, and it's other century kind of art almost.
I think I get very nervous, and then I have some kind of shivering, and it's not good for sound, and not good for then we have a work by Corey Archangel, and it's the Plasma Burn-In TV, so he just put on his sort of credits on the plasma, and he kept it on for a really long time, so it was burned in, and after a while, he didn't have to put anything, it just sort of shone all the time. I put a bit more contrast on the photo so you could read it better, but this is an artwork that shows sort of the material of the plasma. And then there's a third one. Is the sound okay? It's a video by GoToEti and me. GoToEti will perform this week as well in Semetics Festival, and if you're still around, it's really worthwhile, it's really great. He also makes music with noise artifacts, but then with the Commodore 64, normally. This is not with the Commodore, it's just destroyed analog... well, destroyed analog transmission. I made a music video with Commodore Music. And the last one is by Jody. Last year I was performing in Cymatics, and I did it with Jody actually. And all they did was really funny because I had to collaborate, so we had to have some kind of exchange of stuff. And I get an email, of course, with Jody text that says nothing but signs. And I get this zip file of broken LCD screen cracks. And it's photos, it's not even moving. So I have to, as a visualist that does stuff with moving images, I have to do something with this. And I tried to make some kind of glitch videos with it. It was really interesting because a couple of months later, or even later, like May, they made actual performances where they were just hammering the LCDs and they sort of exploded into this rainbow effect, and it was very nice. So they sort of played with how LCD displays can give some kind of medium fingerprint, and how you can use this to make art as well. Second point, dispute operating templates of creative practice, fight genres and expectations, and sometimes even interfaces. An example of this is 5-fold core. They are sort of data bending the computer live. They put 5-fold on this motherboard, and you get these outputs. And they do these performances until the computer says, stop, I don't work anymore. And then it's finished. Performance. Get away from the established action scripts and join the avant-garde of the unknown. Become a nomad of noise. So, and say there's multiple noise artifacts. You can have compression artifacts, you can have feedback artifacts, you can have glitches. You can have even more, or things that you can sort of put into these categories. And use them to find some new way of making a visual. I think noise is, there's multiple ways to explain noise. And German started by describing it as Rauschen. And it's more like this, the sounds of the things around us that are not really explained by us. Or sometimes it's even natural noise that is just very aggressive, like thunder or whatever. But later this sort of started to be a more cultural explanation. Started to become part of information theory. This thing here that many people don't like, the scheme. But it's also been translated to the arts. And in the arts, noise means something else. It's very paradoxical still, but it's more people make some kind of void of meaning. There is nothing to understand anymore. If you look at these screens by Jody, for instance, you're like, what does it mean? It means nothing, it's just destroyed. So this kind of artwork is not just a part of information theory. It's taken out there and put into some kind of art theory. And I think this is a different way to define noise. It's more cultural, and there's different issues at play to describe it. I have three other examples. So RYBN, last year at Cymatics, they showed a compression artwork. And you just had to look at these DivX compressions that sort of slowly evolved into like more and more dotty visuals that sort of appeared while the sound of the music got more volume. Then the contrast was turned up, and there were more spots, because normally the visuals would have been almost black. But then, so if you put the contrast up, you see these blobs of the compression come more and more. So it was very boring, but it was a very nice concept. The second is by Botborg, is from New Zealand as well. It's more feedback related. It's very intense to watch. I haven't seen it, only on YouTube, so I won't explain too much about this. And the last one is Beflix, who plays with, he's like the grandmaster of glitches, and he kind of makes his visuals that are, sometimes they are pure glitch, like you really don't know what happened, and sometimes He seems to just have made an image that looked like a glitch. So he has this paradox in his work that I had to struggle with while developing this glitch manifesto. Use the glitch as an exoskeleton of progress. This is an artwork also made on the Commodore, and it helps us to play with less competition, but more fun and more visuals. So what they did was Code 80 and Outerboy, they made a game that sort of gets destroyed while you play it. So it starts out as just a hockey game, but after a while most of the screen sort of disappears into these blocks of the Commodore, and after some point it's almost not playable, but you just get these really nice looking visuals if you like what it looks like. So what you can do is not only as an artist challenge the hardware or the software, but also the input can be destroyed. If you put some kind of bad code into Photoshop, then you get a really weird image back if you put it in RAW. Or the public can just see an image and say, I don't understand it, to me this is a total glitch. So there's different actors at work when you define a glitch. So what is really important with this is that you have to sort of make a difference between how work was produced and how it is understood in reception. And I think both entrances in this kind of art can define a work of glitch art as a glitch. It doesn't need to be a glitch at first, but if the recipient, the public, really thinks, oh, this really is glitchy, then you can still sort of say, okay, apparently this falls under some kind of glitch way of or glitch art. So it's very problematic always to describe what is a glitch. It's not just you have to take into account, or some kind of dictionary way of finding out if it's a glitch, but you have to really take multiple perspectives. The gospel of glitch art sings about new models implemented by corruption. I'm of the opinion that the popularization and cultivation of glitches is all sort of predestined and almost unavoidable. And I think there's been a couple of incidents over the last year that this really was shown quite well. Like, for instance, this is a film by Takeshi Murata, and he makes these DivX or MPEG compressed movies. And by deleting one keyframe, you get this, like, yeah, this kind of drooling effect on the video, as you see here. And this was sort of, yeah, quite kind of special for a lot of years, like until the beginning of this year. And then suddenly there was Kanye West, who used the same kind of artifact into his video. And then there were all these people that were starting to make this kind of art as well. And then unavoidably there was suddenly a plugin and a software, and now there's many people who are developing some kind of similar plugin to make this kind of compression artifact that used to be something that was created by exploiting the media, opening up the cover, seeing what happens in the black box, and trying to find out what the technology does. And now people just have this ready-made sort of software, and they can make just an end product. They don't have to go through the whole procedure of finding out how the technology works. And I think this is very interesting, and it happens a lot with new glitches. They kind of get exploited, they get into this new mode, they become a new language, they become a new way of operating. So they're no longer a glitch as something you don't understand, but they become some kind of more a metaphor of something that used to be not normal. So what you can see is you're having this normal working, or not as an artist, you have this idea of breaking something. Then suddenly something breaks, you're thinking, what happens? You have to think, you see something, it means nothing, you have the void of no meaning, you don't know how to interpret it. And then suddenly you think, oh, it's a glitch. And you're past this momentum of where you didn't understand it, you didn't know how to call it, you call it a glitch. So this is the momentum of glitch, where there's like loads of ways of interpreting what it is, or even loads of ways how it can follow up. And then suddenly, you know, it's a glitch and becomes a new way, and sometimes even a new filter. So there's multiple parts in what is a glitch, especially in glitch art, I would say. And in glitch art, this last part has become part of glitch art, where people already know what it is. It's normal, but they still refer to it as glitch art. And I think it's very important to see that there's different ways of working and developing glitch art. Yeah, this is a bit of a problem, because we think, okay, glitch can be some kind of democratizing or anti-populist kind of, this kind of way of critiquing the mass media, but in the end it sort of becomes eaten and part of mass culture, as we see here, where America's Next Top Model uses glitches for the starting credits of its new season. And you have this like sort of developing model, and where it becomes a norm, where it becomes normal, where it becomes perfect again. And I thought it was very interesting to see this in such a real American program. So I really enjoy this, actually, as some kind of critique towards this like utopian view of the glitch. Because it's not that much an utopia in the end. This is just, it could be, but not always happens. So the ambiguous contingency of glitch depends on its constantly changing materiality. With which I mean, materiality is more than just a machine on which the glitch plays. It can be also the interpretation, the culture in which it's set, and this changes the glitch, this changes the perspective on the glitch, on the thing that happened, on the break of the flow, or the eruption, what you can see here is all these different things are different ways to play with a NES console. Most of us know NES, I think. We played with it when we were young, or still. The upper one from Nintendo, an American circuit bender, also for VJs, in Berlin, I think, now. He really circuit bended. It was kind of the way it started with the NES to make the glitches, is changing the software or circuit bend the hardware. And this is just a still from his videos. Then No Carrier, from also the US thought, oh, that's interesting, but not everybody can sort of circumvent the NES and make these visuals. I should distribute this as a tool. So he wrote the Glitch NES, which is just software where you can make these ROMs glitch, but they're already like set sprites. So you can just sort of scroll through glitch sprites, which is not really the procedural thing of the glitch that happened in the CircuitPen NES console. And I did another thing. I actually opened up a ROM on my computer and I edited the hex code. And so the ROM didn't play as it should be. The software was not as it should be. So I got this weird sort of visuals. These are actually four that I put together. So these are different ways to get to the same kind of idea, but they are with a different kind of materiality in mind. This specific console has changed materialities into just a sprite, or not just a sprite, because there's some more to it, but the emphasis of what this apparatus was has relayed into these different artworks. And what I mean by the ambiguous contingency of the glitch is that in the end, the glitch is sort of has these, is even in the same apparatus, the NES, it has different ways of being, and we don't know if it stops somewhere or if it goes on until some kind of new form. And this has made many, many art historians crazy, because they have to find up new ways to describe these genres, like data bending, or it's not really art historian way, but they have to find, every time they have to find a new way of describing this genre, coin a new term, and we get this like complete dictionary of ways to glitch, which is not really helpful, because one glitch dies in popularity and then have to find a way to... What I think is we should find another way to describe glitches. As critical transmedia aesthetics. So they don't have to happen in one medium or in one specific way of using this medium, but this kind of mode of working happens in many media, and not just in the 90s or the 60s, but it has happened way beyond, like Glenn Lay, for instance, or maybe even before this. So critical media aesthetics shows that a medium, not only in a critical state where it's ruined and broken, unrecognized, in a state of hypertrophy, but it's also critical to its inherent politics, so how we're supposed to use it, what is normal, how is the interface supposed to act. I think these are two very different ways of describing critical transmedia aesthetics, and that is actually why I like this term. I used the picture by Liebeskind, one of my favorite architectural works, or buildings, because this is also showing something in a horrendous state. And I don't know, it's just a thought. It's more like a thought experiment. Could this be a glitch? I don't want to sort of say yes, but to me there's no opportunity here. This could also be at least a critical transmedia aesthetics. So it would be describing a way of working and a way to break flows that happens in many ways, and not just with a digital tool, but also in architecture, for instance. Translate acousmatic noise and soundscapes into acousmatic video and videoscapes to create conceptual synesthesia. So, mouthful of words. Acousmatic noise comes from Schaeffer, who make new sounds by sort of making some kind of feel, or here you put some kind of musician or sound technician or sound artist, and you don't know how to make the sound, and so this is this acousmatic noise, this, and he creates soundscapes with this. And I think if you now look at the computer, that is this, I mean, okay, yeah, if some kind of idea. Here's the video card. Actually, I have a lot of ideas because I had to open it up 2 weeks ago, so now I know better what's in where. But normally, when you don't have to open up your computer, you don't know exactly what is where or what influences what piece of hardware or software. You have no idea. It's a black box. So there is actually this like veil over your technology of you can't look into it. So it's this kind of acousmatic video that you could make. It's not the it's not the right word, but there is some kind of analogy to this kind of making video and making noise, sound noise, that you could exploit. And that's what I've been doing. And I want to show an example. But the glitches I make are not always playable on every computer. This is a video that I made first by making feedback. So I put the camera onto the screen, I recorded the loop, and I put the loop into the video's memory, and then I sort of cut up these different things, and I compressed them. First by making a MOV out of it, so just a normal movie file, then exporting it to an AVI, which is great, you get all these like blocky things. And then I exported it again to a MOV and then to AVI. It only worked, it doesn't work anymore so well as it used to, because there's some kind of QuickTime update, very nice. Then I had this video that was doubly compressed, like in this like retarded way of thinking, what would happen if I would do this again and again and again? So this is what I do when I'm bored. I try out many compressions. And then I cut it up and I put it into, what was it, fireworks, where you make the animated GIFs? And I made animated GIFs of it. And first you just had this blocky film, but then suddenly the film was all, like you see here, there was no like feedback, sort of has some kind of fluid form still, especially when it's analog. And now it was just like, well, all these blocks that didn't have to do anything with each other anymore. And I made this video and then I sent it to Extra Boy and I said, Extra Boy, I have this nice, really weird video and I need some music that fits with it. So he started composing and what he did, he used a transistor radio. It's this normal noisy radio that you have handheld. And he sort of scratched it on the wall and you get this like noise, you know? Oh, no, but you will hear it soon. And he put some kind of, I think it was Atari sounds, but sort of some kind of voice, folk, yeah, how do you say, vocoder, voice, but whatever. And then also made some kind of nice electronica, kind of to make it a bit more pretty, because the video is actually very pretty, and I always choose the pretty images anyway, because I think if it's very, very dirty and just ugly, it's not very interesting to me or an audience, so I mostly only use the pretty images. And yeah, what came out of it? I have to... Oh yeah, it doesn't play normal on this computer, so I have to do a trick. But I have to find the thing first. Ooh, interesting. Ah, that's good. Oh, Bram, your computer is so beautiful. It's very different from mine. Desktop, yes. The amount of stuff that's on here is very... Now, I have to zoom in because it doesn't do full frame rate if I don't zoom in, which is a bit of a shame, but it's also really... Oh, this is not working either. Sorry for cursing. That's not. I can move away the pointer, so you'll have to enjoy the pointer. Oh, and it's also not starting from the start. Thank you. it's all in loop. Yeah, it's kind of an older video, it's a year old, but it's one of my favorites, so I had to show it anyway. Yeah, so when you listen to the sound, these sort of newfound sounds, or the video, the newfound video, oh, it's there already, I was looking for it. Then you sort of only can wonder where they came from. You have to listen to where they originated from. But because it's this technology that has been obfuscated, that has been veiled by the books, you just have to guess. You'll never really know. So this is where I see some kind of analogy between some kind of soundscape, and maybe we could make a videoscape where the sound and the video don't just come together because you transcode one into another. You don't just put the sound to make or generate a new video image, but actually you use the concept of a destroyed image, how you destroyed the sound, how you destroyed the sound. Did you do it by compression, or did you do it by some other kind of noise? And you try to find some kind of analogy into making some kind of synthesis, actually, between the sound and the visual. Speak the totalitarian language of this creation. This is, yeah, Jody. I mean, I have some kind of weak spot for them, so I cannot leave them out, although we've all seen it, you know. Or maybe Jody is this Dutch-Belgium art collective, and they make a lot of glitch art already since the 90s. And this is one of their, well, not so new, but kind of new works. It's a Blogspot, web blog. And what they did was they just put a lot of noise, a lot of nothing, a lot of destroyed language that has no kind of syntax or whatever. Or it has some kind of syntax, but it still doesn't make sense. Like, it's supposed to make sense on a weblog, you know? So, actually, Blogspot, the Google-owned blog software, they sort of found this blog, and they're like, okay, this doesn't make sense. Maybe it's a virus or some kind of malware, and actually the best thing that could happen to such a work when it gets really accepted into this popular popular culture for what it is, it got deleted. So not everything, but pointer here. You see here they made some entries in some other blogs, and they just got deleted by Blogspot. So they got some real recognition from what you do makes no sense. Okay, we're this like democratic enhancing tool where everybody can start their own blog and shout out whatever they want, but this is just nothing, we're going to delete it. And that's what they did. And it really shows this kind of political wave that glitch can have in showing what is normal, what are your norms. The social psychology of what is supposed to happen, and what do we expect? How's the interface supposed to react? So it could be a democratic utopia again, but I don't know. It's interesting. So yeah, Glitch Peak is a sort of a joke on George Orwell, if you would like that or not. Final point. Ah, there we get it again. This is that won't work. Study what is outside of knowledge. Make a glitch studies. Glitch studies is about the omnipresent constructedness of our daily lives, our daily black boxes, our daily semi-open boxes. And they sort of show how you can break with them, or you sort of try to write some kind of historiography about these broken flows, about these broken ways to criticize, about how we jump into new ways to criticize. And this critical media aesthetics, how does it sort of develop over the years from whenever you want to start? For me, my interests lay a bit later, but maybe you could use it for now, or for then. I want to finish with a statement that was my favorite, and that just sort of got blocked by Caspar David Friedrich, Wanderer in Above the Sea and Fog. It's a beautiful painting. I destroyed it myself. Glitch studies, glitch theory is just what you can get away with. There's where it ends. That's my final statement. Oh yeah, and thank you, Geert and Bram. Geert for glitching my glitch studies all the time.
Just for remark, I'm familiar with this video on ecological origin of pitches, of slides, having slides, and badly activated slide projector. It's great.
Oh, it sounds great. Yeah, you have to write it down, I think. But it sounds great. I think also it sort of refers to this kind of art where people don't just sort of go into the medium, but also this explosive art or tearing or just, well, it's kind of similar to what Joey does, just throwing it. It's all this kind of like really aggressive kind of art. There's kind of a connection to it. I'm getting slowly, feel so empty. Yeah. Oh, I have to stop.
Hello. Any other questions? I will just walk.
I wonder if you could say something about your relationship to anatomy and structure. It seems to me that there must be some kind of love-hate relation with that, where noise or glitch requires the interruption or breakdown of some kind of pattern. It's not itself pattern, but could only be in a world in which there is pattern and structure.
Yeah. Yeah, and actually, you remind me of something I wanted to finish with as well, about the glitch studies. Because actually I forgot one of the most important sentences I want to say this now. So, there we go. Foucault said that there can be only madness when there's reason. And Virgilio says there can only be an accident when there is some kind of progression, or there can only be progression without accident. Interesting. And Goldrich says there can only be noise when there's patterns. So I say there needs to be some kind of glitch studies. If we're going to describe making the story of the involvement of machines, we also have to study how they break down.
So what do you look for in a pattern? Is it more rigid pattern, more exciting? What's exciting in a pattern then? Is it more rigid pattern exciting to experiment with? Do you look for one that's in some kind of state of decomposition, or is there?
I think for me, the final design is important, of course. But my personal practice is more procedural. So I said there's artists that focus mostly on the design. They don't very well into this procedural and working with glitches. They just make a design that looks alive or was created by some kind of glitching software. For me, I think the most interesting is how to the final design or the final feel of the glitch sort of shows me this radicalness or not, or this cuteness. I don't know. There's this feeling towards how the technology was at first. So what was that? It's more like to it than just how it looks, the materiality has to do with it. And then again, it's not just the materials and the computers, more concepts and histories, and cultural money, blah. Yes. More questions? Ooh.
I was just wondering why you used the word totalitarian.
totalitarian speech, yeah, totalitarian language of disintegration. Because when something disintegrates, it's often, or what I like about it, is that that's all that there is. This overrules what you were doing completely, and it's kind of this like monster state relationship towards this new language. Does that answer your question?
Kind of.
Kind of. That's good for me. For somebody like you to ask me a question, that's great. Oh, we have to go back to
the... We can have one more question. Thank you very much, Rosa.